Christ Church. And I have the blessing and gift in my life to work alongside many wonderful people in the Youth Collaborative, which started about a year ago, one of which is Monica Mannering. And Monica is actually going to start for us while I man the slides for a few minutes.
Welcome. I'm so glad you're all here, and I'm guessing by your presence that you have a vested interest in youth, or at least intrigued about what we're doing with youth in the diocese. And so perhaps as a way of beginning, we can say a prayer for youth. And forgive me, I didn't bring the book of common prayer. There's some glorious prayers in there for youth and young people in formation, but I'm going to wing it, if you will. Holy and gracious God, for the gift of serving your children. And I know many of our parishes have been in conversations about how do we attract more youth? Well, Lord God, help us to ask the right questions about what posture we can take, what we can learn indeed from youth, and how we might nurture our faith and spirituality together. And I pray that this time together might be rich, and that you might inspire within us a commitment to serve and disciple and send as apostles youth in this diocese, for we pray it in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
My name is Monica Mannering, as Charlotte introduced me. I was the assistant at Good Samaritan last year, and one of the things that was put on my plate was heading up youth ministry in the parish. And I didn't know what to do with youth because we had very few of them, which might be a familiar case for some of your parishes. And I had, I'll just out myself, my history was that I had worked at a non-denominational church with about 200 people in my high school youth group. So with two or three youth, thinking of pizza night was a paradigm shift for me, and a little bit of a crisis because sometimes only one would show, and then one of the events I did, no one showed up.
Oh.
So if you've ever experienced that kind of discouraging reality,
yes.
There's some nodding heads, so I assume I'm not alone. It kind of birthed the question, why are we doing this apart? Wouldn't we be better together? And so I picked up the phone and called the churches closest to us, or the churches that some of the students in my parish said, oh, we've done something with St. Bart's before, we've done something with so-and-so before. I picked up the phone and called Christ Church because I had interned. I was a parish intern the year before there. And we had an initial meeting in fall of 2014. And in digging up that history, I learned, in fact, there were lots of collaborative efforts. There was something called Happening, some of you might be familiar with, a high school youth retreat that had happened many, many years in a row. And out at Camp Stevens, there were efforts at different mission trips. I knew from that Christ Church often would do a mission trip and at the last minute would get a few phone calls saying, hey, can my student come along? Can my youth come along? And they said yes, but Christ Church had hosted, invested, spent the budget, provided the chaperones. And so when we got together in fall of 2014, again, with just a handful of us, five different youth leaders, we said, well, hey, how about forming more of working together? And how can we do this going forward? Charlotte had that ingenious idea. So we co-founded this youth collaborative, and we had a big meeting in winter of 2015, and laid out kind of what's the need, what do we want to do together, what would youth ministry look like? And I'll talk a little bit more about vision on into the future, but the general kind of shape of that was, let's do some events and see how it goes if all of us can do these events together. And again, I'm going to out myself. I was trying to solve a problem. I needed to get some events on the calendar for my youth to feel engaged and to enjoy church. And I thought, I'll host one and you all can come and that'll feel better. And, you know, we'll have lots of pizza. And then can someone else host one? Well, we did that a few times successfully. And there was a summer mission trip that went well. We did a fall retreat to Camp Stevens. And so we'll talk about these different pieces in a minute. But what happened, there's kind of two things going on. One is this collaborative effort that I think youth are really enjoying, seeing one another a little more often and doing ministry together. And then youth leadership. Now there's kind of a place to support one another, to learn together, to grow, to kind of think and wrestle through how, you know, youth ministry is this very quickly changing landscape. My babysitter this morning, who relieved me of my children so I could be here, used to be the youth pastor at La Jolla Presbyterian Church, which used to have one of those 100-person youth group. And she said, you know, it's odd, in the last 3 years they've got 40 people on their rota, or, you know, on their roster, and 20 come into events. So even the changing shape of how youth spend their time we're kind of needing to get ourselves up on, and that's part of also the youth collaborative conversation. So.
Yeah. So the main thing is, well, I have to say that that first meeting, the first meeting with five of us, the desire, the want, the need for connection, the need not to exist in a void, because youth ministry can't exist all by itself. You need that connection both to your youth and to other people that are doing it, because they're the ones that foster your creativity, both with the kids and when you're at your desk and you're trying frantically to wrap your head around what this retreat is going to look like. You need that support network built in. Those people that you can call on the phone and be, this isn't working the way that I want it to, or what are you doing for confirmation? These are conversations that work so much better when you have resources and colleagues to reach out to. And not just the colleagues within your parish, but people who are doing your job somewhere else. And that's been the greatest gift of all of this. So we went from that meeting of five to a meeting of 17 at the first gathering, which said how great the need was. And then at our second gathering, you're going to have to excuse me while I walk to the slide, we decided that we needed to have a mission statement of who we are and what we want. And so, and Sydney and Tessa are back there because they're in this picture. There's Tessa. And where's Sydney? Oh, you're over here. And there I am. But anyway, so this was a mission trip with SSP to Navajo Nation, and there are five churches from the area that are represented in this group, and this was two summers ago. And so our mission statement is that the EDSD Youth Collaborative is a collective of San Diego parishes invested in youth ministry. We use our common resources to serve youth and families throughout the diocese. We meet quarterly to plan, collaborate, share events and resources, and provide support to those involved in youth ministry. Collaborative events include mission trips, convention, youth retreats, service opportunities, night watch, and various other activities. Under various other activities, we've had things like impossible games. We have had Episcopal prom. We have, I mean, there has just been so many, there's been laser tag. It's many, many more. And usually what that entails is one parish saying, I want to do this. Do you want to come? And that makes it really fun because a lot of those things, laser tag's no fun if you've got three kids. Right? No targets. So it's been a tremendous blessing for all of us to be in community. And what we're really hoping for us out of Leadership Academy is to welcome more people into this. This is a tremendous opportunity for us to say, hey, here we are. Come be with us. Come be part of this journey, and let's do more together. So from there, we're going to transition to our retreat that we had last October. I'm going to give it back over to you, Monica, to talk about it.
We headed up to Camp Stevens, which is a great resource and familiar to many youth in the diocese, and we're trying to go there more often so that even though someone has a prom and someone has a baseball game and someone else has SATs, that students can look forward to being together, worshiping together, enjoying the peaceful place that is Camp Stevens. So we had a middle and high school high school retreat last October and welcomed a number of students. I think there was 20 some odd of us. Had a theme, Teach Me Your Paths. We talked a lot about the paths that we choose to work on or walk down in life. And so there's an element of discipleship, but also we worked on paths there and we turned up the ground. We to make a trip affordable, we work at Camp Stevens. It's less than $100 if we give them a good 6 hours of hard labor, which is, of course, fun bonding when you're just getting dirty together. So we've had animals and some garden planning, dinner, cooking, games, campfire songs. Bishop Mathis came to our campfire time and told a little bit of his story, which was a really special connection for a lot of youth present, and some time of prayer, and even chicken food was shoveled there. So we have another retreat coming up, we'll talk about later, coming up this spring, and we're going to try to keep these on rota. Something we're trying to build, and again, we're kind of in our infant stages of this collaborative, is a sense in which even a 10-year-old, my child is 9, in this diocese could say, oh, I can't wait until I'm 12 because then I'll do this confirmation thing, or I can't wait till I'm 13 because then this retreat happens. I can't wait till I'm 15 because this mission trip. And so we're trying to kind of build something that can be looked forward to and grown into and could be an integral part of their discipleship.
So next up, Alex, would you join me? And would you have So this first slide about the Diocesan Convention, I just wanted to put up because after our winter meeting, when we had the 17 parishes together, our first attempt at doing anything together was actually a Diocesan Convention in 2014. And it was successful. We had 21 kids come to Diocesan Convention, and we learned about what the business is that is done at convention. We went to some of the voting. We played Capture the Flag and had pizza, and kids got to connect with kids that they hadn't seen since the last time they were on a mission trip together or perhaps had never met. So that was a really fun day. This picture is of this year, which was us at Diocesan Convention just recently. Can we have the next slide? Alex, do you want to talk a little bit about our process? They had to click it twice.
When Charlotte and I first met to talk about what we were going to do at convention, what would it look like for the kids, one of the things that we discussed is what is central to our worship, what is central to our faith, and it's the table. And one of the things that we hear a lot of is the kids are the church of tomorrow. The kids are the church of today, and they have a place at the table. And it became very clear to us that we are going to gather around that table together. And it was our place at the table. One of the things that we started out with, you can see the TV in the background, is we watched a documentary called A Place at the Table, which discussed hunger and need in our country and how it is affected by, well, the government, community, and culture. And we were able to have a discussion with the kids about that and what we can do as a church to help support our communities, to feed the hungry, to be Christ in this world. You want to go through the whole thing?
Yeah, can we have one more slide?
Well, it looked like this.
Let's pause for one moment just because I did her a disservice. Alex, can you just tell everybody where you're from?
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, yes, hi. I'm Alex Howard. I am the family minister at St. Andrews by the Sea in Pacific Beach. I have been working with children professionally for 16 years. I've been working with children in youth ministry for 2 years, and I'm happy to say that I have never been more excited to work with children and youth than I have been since joining the Youth Collaborative. It is energizing, it is life-giving, and I get to work with some of the most remarkable people. And we are blessed to have this community.
All right.
So from that back on.
So we started with the video presentation, and then we really took that table theme all throughout the day with the kids. And so our conversation around the table is, what is your place at the table at home, at church, in the diocese? And I wish that I had brought with me, and I did not, some of their cards that they wrote, because some of the kids, of course, left them behind. But some of the things that they came up with were so powerful and so eye-opening, these little, because teens, anybody that works with teens know, if you want to know, you just need to ask. They're going to tell you, right? They're like, it may be on there, my place at home is that my brother beats me up all the time, right? Like, it could be. My place at home is that I play video games in my room by myself. Youth group is where I feel connected, right? So it was a really powerful tool for us to look at and to help us decide what we wanted to do together, the other ways that we wanted to engage them going forward. So then Alex had this awesome presentation, which was, what do you bring to the table?
And that was an eye-opening discussion amongst the kids. But there's also an opportunity to create. So we took a very large cloth and we covered the table where we met, and the kids created an altar cloth that says they have a place and their place is valued, and they were able to be creative and have a voice and express it through art on our altar cloth.
And so from there we went in, I know, every time, right? From there we went in for the Eucharist and the ordination. We gathered for lunch with everybody else that was at convention. We decided this time not to do pizza separately, that we really wanted to give people the opportunity to talk to us and the kids to talk to everybody else. So we all went to lunch together, and it was beautiful there under the trees where we got to have lunch. And then we came back, and all of a sudden, we were out of time. And that's another adventure of youth ministry, is that you have this much programming, and suddenly, sometimes you don't get through this much. But we were able to finalize our conversation with, where do we go from here, and what are our next steps, allowing them to dream a little bit. And some of that was that they wanted to go to Camp Stevens for the retreat that you just saw Monica talking about. Some of that was that service speaks to their hearts, and they were dreaming of things about having a book at a bookshelf at St. David's for when the food pantry is there, so that kids could take a book home while mom and dad are shopping for groceries, and that they want to put together a book drive to make that happen. And so you're not talking about Christ Church wanting to have a book drive. You're talking about seven parishes wanting to do that together for them. So it was a really powerful day for us. So from there, I will give it to Monica and to Susan. And Susan, would you please introduce yourself before you guys talk about Night Watch?
Susan Colbert. I'm a first year at St. Paul's Cathedral. I'm the only one among us who's not really a professional youth minister. I'm a volunteer and a mom. My children, when they went through the youth program at St. Paul's, they were the only ones in each of their grades. So this was before the Youth Collaborative, and we looked around to the diocese to find other places for them to go, just like Charlotte said. Oh, you're going on a mission trip. Could my son go? So the Youth Collaborative really provides a way to for everyone else to do that in a more organized fashion. So, and my background is I'm a lawyer for the Navy. I spent a lot of time before I had children as a minister, later volunteer at my home parish, All Saints, Beverly Hills, and then in Massachusetts. So my children and then the Youth Collaborative have kind of given me an opportunity to get back into something that's really a passion in my life.
St. Paul's, where Susan attends, hosted Night Watch last year, which was an overnight in the cathedral. So we slept in the midst of the pews, which was lovely and odd and not all that spooky, although the organist came and played some spooky music. It was a gathering. We came together. The bishop greeted us. Elaine did a beautiful job. Elaine Turnbull is sitting back here. With some kind of meet and greet games and getting to know one another. The beauty of the Youth Collaborative is that, you know, youth from each parish are also coming from different geographic regions in San Diego, and so different socioeconomic backgrounds, perhaps. And they are meshing thus far so well, so beautifully, and this happened in this overnight. We had some time in different stations that were kind of set up by those at the cathedral, particularly Colin Matthewson, who borrowed this youth idea from another diocese, and time to reflect on sin, time to pray for healing. And the kids really liked this kind of interactive nature at night in a cathedral. I think it had all these kind of sacred elements and also different enough and just for them. No one else gets to do this at the cathedral. So it was real beautiful. And we spent an overnight, mostly slept. Elaine did not sleep at all. She woke people through the night to keep vigil so youth would come forward and pray. I slept through the night, thank you, Elaine. My job just to make sure everyone else is sleeping, so I see in sympathy. And so the cathedral is actually hosting Night Watch yet again. This year we'll make this an annual tradition.
Tonight. So if anybody's
interested, we have 21 signed up. If anybody's interested, please come and see me. It's going to be much as Monica described. Again, with the opportunity for prayer, reflection, the organist will be there again.
And
the bishop will be there.
And the dean will meet us
for
breakfast.
And we also, before Night Watch, there is also another opportunity for others in the diocese. St. Paul's is going to start a baccalaureate program. They have one now in St. Paul's. So each graduating class at St. Paul's has a baccalaureate service. To honor their end of high school years and welcome them into college. And it's a program that has two or three meetings before the service where youth meet with other adult supporters to reflect on their high school experience and to think about the years ahead. So that program is going to be offered diocese-wide at the cathedral this year. And tonight, before Night Watch at 5 p.m., we're going to start with a service, a Taizé service, which Ashley will talk about some more later. And then a discussion about the baccalaureate process. So anybody who's interested in that, please come or see me. If you can't come, my email is available, and you can email me or Robin Taylor.
Do you only do this once a year?
Yes.
Night Watch is once a year.
It's always at this time.
Yes.
It's always, well, this is the second time, and every for both of these years, it's been in February.
Yes.
So, because it's dark, you know, it's really true. Important to have that dark.
Yeah.
The dark is really an essential part of it. So.
I believe the intent from the cathedral is for it to be a Lenten offering every year.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Alex, can I hit you up again?
Oh, one more time, I suppose.
You're going to see a lot of us getting up and getting down, and I'm going to say to you that the reason why that happens is because we collaborate. It's awesome. It means that everybody has their hand in a lot of different goals, and we work together. We're going to take a few minutes, and we're going to talk about what is coming up this coming year for summer mission opportunities for the youth in your parish. This photo was actually last year in Mexico, which is where we are going again this coming year with a high school group. And then a lot of the things with the kids that we really work on and that we teach is that they don't have to be able to do everything. They don't have to be good at everything or know how to do it all or change the world all by themselves, but that there is always something that they can do. And mission very much speaks to that with them.
Okay, this is what we have coming up for middle school students in June. I am very, very excited. It will be two nights where we will be staying at St. Mark's. It is the Urban Immersion Weekend. We're going to start out on Friday afternoon volunteering with Canyonlands, doing a hands-on project in the area in City Heights. And one of the reasons that we are going to City Heights is, one, Heather Smith, who is fantastic, if you haven't met her, does tremendous work in City Heights. It is a thriving and diverse neighborhood with so much to offer. We will be staying at St. Mark's. We will be using the portable showers, the Showers of Blessings. And we will be sleeping in the sanctuary. Now let me go back to where we're going to start on Friday is volunteering with Canyonlands, doing hands-on physical work cleaning in the canyons, then coming back to St. Mark's to debrief and have dinner. And then Saturday we get a little more exciting. We will wake up and we will have breakfast, and then the kids are going to be given a few dollars to go to the farmers market in City Heights. It's only a couple blocks away. So they are going to get creative and work together to go shopping at the farmers market, and then they are going to be given access to St. Mark's food pantry. We were hoping to volunteer at the food pantry, but schedule-wise, it just didn't work. So the kids will have access to the food pantry just as anyone else does, going through the same process, and then they will be making lunch together. This is about walking along with our neighbors in City Heights. City Heights has a large refugee community. It is home to the International Rescue Community, which only has 14 locations in the United States, and one of them happens to be in San Diego. We are also in close proximity to the Episcopal Refugee Network offices, so there is a lot going on there. So we will have lunch, and then Heather is putting together a middle school refugee panel so the kids can speak to their peers about their experience coming to America, what has been challenging, what has been a blessing. And it will give that face time and that human connection. So it isn't obscure, it isn't a news piece. This is their life and how do we walk together. After that, we are going to walk over to Red Sea Ethiopian Restaurant, where we are going to have a family style dinner with the owners of the restaurant. I'm so excited about this. Because the restaurant is delicious, but also this, all of this time for us to be together. An experience together. This isn't a come look, this isn't philanthropic tourism, this is hands-on for our middle schoolers. Then we will worship at St. Mark's on Sunday morning, and then we will go forth into the world to share what we have learned together over those 2 days.
So before I go into my note, I do want to give Alex credit for something that she took no credit for while she was standing up here, which is this is the very first time that we have offered a mission trip for middle schoolers. So it has always been a high school thing. And Alex said, no, I want to do something for the middle schoolers. So she dreamed it, she coordinated with Heather, and this year, for the first time, we are offering the opportunity for mission to middle school.
It wouldn't have happened without the collaboration.
Yeah! So, now, transitioning to high school, I'm taking a group again to Mexico with Amor Ministries. We went last year, and I'm going to speak very briefly because there is a link, as you see there. I want to show you our slideshow from last year, so I will be brief so that we can watch the slideshow. The trip last year was incredible. 2 years before, we had gone to Navajo Nation, which was 11 hours in a van. We didn't get to complete our project there because it was with SSP, and that's planned out over 6 weeks. And that was a wonderful experience, but it was really hard for the kids not to be like, okay, here's your new shed, or here is your ramp that we worked on. Instead, all they got to do was pour a foundation or put up the framing. And so even though the week was wonderful, the takeaway, there was a little bit of heartache that went with it of not being able to complete. So last year, we wanted a project that we could complete in the time we were gone. So we built two houses in 4 days without a single power tool, which I did not know when I signed up. It was tent camping, bucket showers, porta potties, and it was the most amazing week of my entire life. The kids were tremendous. I know there was a lot of concern about safety in when we're crossing the border. I felt completely safe the whole time, and my own child was on the trip. We took vans down to the Amor Ministry Center in Chula Vista, and then they take you across the border, a van in front of your caravan, a van at the back, take you across, you caravan all the way down to where you're staying. It's a gated, secured area. When you go in, you give them one half of, you have a key fob that's two pieces, you give them one half to show that you're going in, and then when you're going out, you get it back. So you cannot get in or out unless you have a key fob to give, and they're all logged and dated and who has what. There were people that patrolled the grounds, went all the way around, making us safe at night. There was also a rooster that thought that dawn was 2:30 a.m. And wild dogs that barked off in the distance, and all sorts of fun things that you wouldn't get to experience anywhere other than in rural Mexico. But the kids did it all. I'm going to show you the slideshow, and you can see the dates are there. The information on the program will be coming out this week. I hope to have it out last week, but I had some computer issues. So it will be out this coming week with all of that. But Monica, if you'll start the slideshow, I will. We're going to listen to my iPhone because I realized we didn't have sound for our slideshow through the computer. So, all right. Did you get it? Thank you. It needs more coffee. All right. be there. It really was, I mean, can I just say, Sydney and Tessa, how was it?
It was amazing.
Yeah. They were both on the trip. And they had both gone to SSP the year before, which was really fun, too.
Oh, yeah.
But this was a really tremendous experience for us. So when we went on that trip, just briefly, there were 32 kids and 8 adults that went on that trip, and we built 2 houses. This year, I have 50 spots reserved currently for youth. But Amore is amazing and has said that up to 1 month out, I can double that number if I want to. So we have the potential to take 100 kids with us if we are able to. Okay. So now I'd like to introduce Ashley Eisenhower, who is not just new to her position, but also new to the West Coast. And let her tell you about Tazay, which is a new offering for us.
Hey guys. So my name is Ashley Eisenhower. Like Charlotte said, I am the Director of Youth Ministries at St. James by the Sea in La Jolla. And like she said, I am brand spanking new, not only to San Diego, but also to youth ministry. The majority of my experience with Episcopal youth is from camp. I am a camp director at Shrine Mount Camps. It's in Virginia. It's with the Episcopal Diocese of Virginia there. So I spent the last few summers working as the camp director for their music and drama camp. So that's kind of how I fell in with the Episcopal youth crowd. And then the job opened up at St. James, and I came here. My fiance is a student, a PhD student at UCSD, so that's how we kind of migrated from St. Louis. And so essentially, at Shrinemont, something that we did a lot was Tazay. We did a lot of Tazay worship services. And great thing about the collaborative was when I showed up and I had no idea what I was doing. Emphasize, no idea what I was doing. And I was put in touch with Charlotte, and it was this beautiful, beautiful moment of, oh my gosh, there are people out there. They want to listen to me. They want to listen to me. They want to bounce ideas off of me. And Tazay is something that I'm really passionate about because of my personal experience. So that's the other thing that the collaborative does is, hey, this is something I want to do. Do you maybe want to do it? And Charlotte was like, not only do I want to do it, let's do it once a month. And so a little bit about Tazay, in case you don't know. A Tazay worship service is inspired from the ecumenical monastic community of Tazay, France. And it's a little community in the hills in France, and they are very proud in that they welcome people from all over the world, from different Christian traditions. To celebrate with them, and they work for them, kind of like with Camp Stevens, when you go and you work for the community. When you go to Tazay, when you make the pilgrimage to Tazay, you are working for them, and then you pray with them, and you worship with them, and it's this really beautiful, intentional community, and so the service is kind of mirrored off of that. And a Tazay music service is very similar to other services, other worship services, but there's an element of meditative singing, or chanting. And it's really beautiful. It's very, I will use the word intentional a lot because I really love that word, especially in youth ministry. So the music of Tazay is very intentional in that you are chanting and you are singing the same couple of lines over and over and over until, you know, you kind of get that feeling that we're ready to move on. And it gives people the time to really reflect in that moment the words that they're saying and the relationship with God that they have in that moment. And so the reason that I wanted to bring it to the Youth Collaborative is that Tazay in and of itself is really geared towards youth and young adults. I mean, in Tazay, in France, you cannot be over the age of 30 if you want to go. So I've got like a year to get there and like do it. But the reason that I think is so important for youth is that it really challenges them to look outside of this preconceived notion of what church is and where God is. You know, they're in school and they're being told this is right, this is wrong, this is how you do this, this is how you do that. And with Tazay, you can do it in the woods. At camp, we did it in the woods all the time. You can do it on the beach, you can do it in a park, you can do it in a church. You will see in April, we are literally doing it on top of a mountain because we can. And so it challenges youth to really understand and explore the fact that God is everywhere. God is where they need for him to be. And truly, also, if you think about the way that youth live nowadays, right now, they're constantly connected to their phones, to their computers, to other people. They're incredibly busy. Something you guys can probably all attest to is they don't show up to things because they're doing gymnastics, they're doing soccer, they're doing football, they're doing a play, they're doing a recital. And so offering this Tazay service to them is truly offering them the moment of silence, just 1 hour of silence to truly reflect about their relationship with God and where they happen to see God. And so that's kind of where this idea of offering it monthly came, is, well, first of all, we're going to be doing kind of a rotating Teze offering. So tonight we're starting it at Night Watch, the first time that we're doing it. So tonight it's at St. Paul's. Next month I'm hosting it at St. James by the Sea. And then, like we said, April it's going to be on top of Cowles Mountain during a full moon hike. I believe that Alex has offered to host it in May, and then I think we just need to find someone in June. So it's really taking off, and it really has this great momentum. And I think kind of my reasoning for wanting to do it is that offering to them each month of, hey, you guys are really busy, you guys are probably really stressed out, I'm offering you this time to truly sit and have that quiet moment with God, which I think is really important with youth and young adults, because they are starting to navigate their own personal spiritual path. And I think if we give them tools to find those quiet moments and to find those moments with God, then in the future when they are starting to really get fully immersed in life's challenges, they have those tools. And I think it's our job to kind of help them with that.
Thank you, Ashley.
Yeah, thank you.
Susan, you are up. Susan is back with us to talk about a forward-thinking thing for us, because EYE is coming up and we need to plan in advance in order to be able to go next summer.
Okay, this seems like it's far, far in advance, EYE 2017 summer, but the planning will begin this summer, so everyone needs to have it in their minds, because the planning process and the identification of kids who want to come, that starts in the fall. So when I went to EYE at the last minute. I was a substitute chaperone, and I didn't know what to expect at all, and what I found was transformational, as well as transformational for the three good kids who went. So last year we had three kids from the Diocese of San Diego who went to the Episcopal Youth event. They were all from St. Paul's Cathedral. Next time we hope to have a lot more from a lot of different parishes. Before I went, I said, what is EYE? I asked a lot of people, and no one could tell me, oh, you're going to love it. It's great. It's great. That's mostly what I heard. So really what EYE is, what Ashley was saying, Teze is an opportunity to be quiet and reflective and intentional. And that's part of EYE, but EYE is an opportunity for kids to go out and meet tons of other kids who also are part of church. So that EYE has about 800 kids and 400 chaperones, all on fire about God, Jesus, and the Episcopal Church. So, and just to give you a rundown of what we do with EYE, because that kind of gives you an idea. This year, last year's 2014 EYE, it was in Philadelphia. 2017 will probably be somewhere in the western United States. 2011 was in San Antonio. So it's the second largest gathering of Episcopalians, the first being the General Convention, and it's held a couple years after the General Convention, every 3 years. So, it begins with lots of icebreakers for the kids. One of the icebreakers was all the kids made banners from their diocese to use in opening worship. And there's our Diocese of San Diego banner. There are morning and evening prayer offerings led by some of the rock stars of the Episcopal Church, Stephanie Spellers, Reverend Becca Stevens, who founded Thistle Farms. And you can see the presiding bishop. She was there for the entire time. And the closing Eucharist, the preacher was our new presiding bishop, Michael Curry, who set those kids on fire. They went out of there. His message was, go. And they went out of there, go. And three of them, who came from the Diocese of San Diego, downloaded his sermon. It's on YouTube. And they showed it to all the kids they could find. And they still watch it. They sent to one of them's in college, and he said to me the other day, can you send me that Bishop Curry's sermon? So he had a lasting impact on the kids. So there's also workshops for the adult leaders as well as the kids. So they're on everything from the confirmation process, the Episcopal Church at the UN, faith in films, trafficking and prostitution, and all kinds of stuff that you can find your interest across the board. Again, the focus last time was on the five marks of mission, and all of the teaching leading up to going to EYE was focused on that. I'm not sure what it's gonna be this time. But along with that, for the one day, the kids went out into the city of Philadelphia. They were divided in groups, and basically to see what the Episcopal Church was doing in the city of Philadelphia for the underserved. So first, to begin with, every kid went to Christ Church, because that's where the Episcopal Church was founded. And there they met the Bishop of Philadelphia and learned about the history of the church. And after that, they found out to different places like Episcopal Community Services, which has a great program for after school, for kids in after school, and we saw movies that they had made and a lot of work that they had done. They themselves were doing volunteering. We also went to a food pantry that's held in one of the most beautiful, oldest, wealthiest churches in Society Hill in Philadelphia, and they feed thousands of people every week. And they're using their lot next door to build another building that's going to be an office building, and that money is going to go all completely toward feeding people in the city around them. That was all culminated in a party on the steps of the Philadelphia Art Museum. So everybody got to run up the steps like Rocky Balboa. And at the top, they had a band and dance music, and the food from Philadelphia cheesesteaks and, you know, all kinds of. So there was lots of bonding opportunities there for the kids. That was from the Art Museum. These are kids from Western Michigan. Our kids had a chance to meet Episcopal youth from all over the country. We were housed with the Diocese of Hawaii, which has 35 people there, so that's my goal, to get to as many as the Diocese of Hawaii, because they came from a long way. Our kids did 4 days of the Episcopal Youth Event, and then there were 2 days after that were mission in the city of Philadelphia. So when we go in 2017, the Diocese of San Diego is committed to doing the second 2 days also. We just didn't know about it because we were kind of late to the game last time. But this time we know about it, and that's going to be part of the planning. And the kids who did that, because our kids are friends with a lot of the ones who went to that, and they were highly disappointed that they weren't continuing on. So those kids went into Philadelphia, and our kids went on. We took them on a tour of Valley Forge, and that was not as popular. I enjoyed it. But anyway, next time, that's what we're going to be doing, and we will be going on the mission part of the trip. Anyone who has an interest in this, please let me know or Charlotte, and we'll get the information to you. We hope to have the location identified this summer, and then we'll start working with hopefully kids that are interested in going.
Thank you. Last one. All right, will you join me up front, Monica? All right, so this is our contact information, important things you need to know slide, and the last slide you get to see today. At the bottom, we decided that it would be helpful to calendar out the whole year for when we will meet as leadership. So we will gather on April 9th at St. Paul's Cathedral, August 13th at St. Andrew's by the Sea, and then we are having our first Youth Collaborative Retreat at Camp Stevens in October, where we're hoping to have some education opportunities for all of us involved in youth ministry, as well as some more time for collaboration and planning. Which brings us, planning is the perfect word to take us to visioning, and I know that Monica wanted to talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, I'm so grateful. I hope this has been useful thus far. We'll have a little bit of Q&A at the end, but I hope you'll get the word out to your parishes and parishes around you if you're not already connected in a big way to the collaborative. some of you might have heard NPR feel like either I'm hearing the same thing over and over, or they're doing a whole series on voting in Kensington and City Heights. Maybe you've heard this. They're doing a lot of interviews because Kensington voter turnout is quite high, and City Heights voter turnout is notoriously quite low. And so they're saying, but the decisions made kind of for that municipality are made by the vote. And so they're trying to encourage City Heights folk to place their vote, right? Kensington might have a particular interest. It's a more affluent area. And so they've just noted how the people who show up are the people who have power and money and get to make decisions and get to have all their lovely programs for themselves. And the people who don't show up, of course, are disempowered. It's my analogy for the collaborative is trying to really turn around that trend. We're in a diocese with 40-some-odd parishes, some with youth programs, some of them with full-time youth leadership, some with no semblance of any youth leadership or youth mentors. And so as church, we really want to kind of say, we can do better than just improving voter turnout. We can do things together and do things with a mind for everybody in the diocese. So there's a not yet in print, but a scholarship fund to help scholarship people who want to go to the mission trip and don't have the means. Same is true for retreats. All of the events, always, you know, where there's a way, we're going to make it happen, that all youth are always welcome. And what we need, again, is lots of ambassadors to go from this place and communicate with parishes that aren't yet connected. We have I've done some cold calling, we've done emails, we've connected in every way we can thus far. And not everyone has yet taken advantage of coming to the collaborative meetings, but representation is certainly important. But our hope, in terms of visioning for the future, is that everything we do, as I said in the beginning, you know, really puts youth on board to feel like, one day I can go on an international mission trip. One day, in my high school term, you know, because it comes with every 3 years, I can go to EYE. One fall, I can go to a retreat, or one spring. That these things are placed there, and the youth ministry in this diocese, there have been times where people have had longer stays in their positions or in their volunteership, and then a lot of turnover, which is just kind of the ball game in youth ministry, is that there's forever been lots of turnover. So what we're trying to establish with the collaborative is, no matter which people are in and out of that, there will always be there will be youth ministry existing with perhaps different volunteers running that. So I myself transitioned into a role sharing an office with Charlotte. We've co-founded and co-convened this group and continue to, but I no longer have in my job description, as I did at Good Sam, direct contact with youth or kind of youth ministry in my purview. So then we're watching other people step up and take on more roles, and I'm so grateful for that. We're really trying to also have a discussion, maybe there'll be time here or into the future, about vision in terms of what do we want to make sure that we take care of. I know a number of people in the Episcopal Church have said, oh gosh, we kind of failed a whole generation in terms of discipleship or faith that has some staying power. There's been a lot of jokes about, oh, we sent them off to college and, you know, they'll have their years away and then they'll come back. But guess what? Statistically, no one's coming back. Right? Because these are these years of formation, vocational discernment. So we really believe, and I'm so glad the bishops really put forth in his mission, youth matter, that we've got to put a lot of focus here. And so again, I just encourage all of you to be a part of connecting to this in whatever way you feel appropriate, but certainly acting as an ambassador too.
So before we go into Q&A, which we're going to do right now, I would be remiss if I didn't say two things. And one, the first thing is how incredibly supportive the diocese has been to us. This did start as a grassroots effort, but we have received nothing except for help and willingness and what's next and what do you want to do. So we are so tremendously appreciative of walking side by side with the diocese in this, that the collaborative benefits tremendously from that relationship. And we have a budget, as Monica said, so that we will be able to scholarship kids. We're working out what that will look like, but we have things to do now that we've never been able to do. So that's really a wonderful opportunity for all of us. And then the other thing that I would like to do is, if you want to be connected, if you are a youth minister, great. If you are not a youth minister, all this does means is that I'm going to send you an email and say, who should I contact at your parish? If it's you, that's great, but if not, then you can give me the right contact info then. You don't have to have it on you right now in order to be successful. And also as part of that, we will be sending out a monthly newsletter via email that will really tell you what's coming up in the next month and what things you need to be looking for long-range planning. So, yes, Elaine.
I just want to mention one thing about tonight, Night Watch. One of the projects that our kids are working on is called the Faith Net, and it's actually a fishing net, and they're going to be tying prayers to it. And what we decided to do is, after they're done with it tonight, it's going to pass on to all of our other parishes, and we're going to ask your youth to add their prayers to it. And then it will be on display at convention in November. So please watch for that net to come with prayers from all of our youth from the diocese.
Thank you, Elaine. Uh-huh. So Elaine has been an active member of the Youth Collaborative from the very beginning, and has brought so much to all of us, representing kind of two parishes in all that you do, and we're so appreciative of that. Thank you. Does anybody have any questions today? And you can ask any of us, anybody in the room. I think we still have a few minutes in which we can collaborate. Yes.
So this is great. I represent a congregation in Hammett, which is a little bit more geographically removed, and I've sent you some email. Mm-hmm. So we'll try to plug in, but both our, and we will from time to time, but both our economic geographic and our geographic data points restrict how much we can do. For congregations like ours,
yes,
where there's a little nucleus of kids, and there's maybe an adult who would love some mentoring about just how to structure time together. Are some of you available to go out into the field and just spend a little bit of time with us?
Of course. So I would say, well, first of all, because you and I had exchanged emails, and I did bring with me in case anybody else finds himself in a similar position to Kathleen, I've brought my program. So how I run my program, the letter I send out, how it's formulated, all of that. And I also brought a bunch of the resources that I use as well. So I have that for you to take back today, and I'm happy to provide that to anybody. But certainly, we are definitely in the electronic age able to email and phone call and occasionally get together. I would not be opposed to coming to see you. And I would say one of the things that we're excited about is that, well, I'm not sure if it's closer for you or not, but convention is going to be in Palm Desert. So that's good. And we actually have some really exciting things that we're already percolating for that. So that is going to be a good resource for your kids, too. But before you go, please see me, and I do have a handout for you. And that said, also, there's a bunch of handouts over here on upcoming events, including the retreat, Taze services, tonight's Youth Unite event, and things like that as well. Yes?
Well, and building on what she said, we're from Fallbrook, and I was going to ask you something about, because all these churches appear to be kind of down here more south, if some of the people more north got together, rather than you or someone coming to just one place, maybe, you know,
central
because there's
location.
Us in Fallbrook, Temecula, Hemet, whatever else is up
there,
you know, and then.
Yep, and Temecula is connected, and Fallbrook is connected. Like, they may not be here today, but you have had representatives at the Youth Collaborative meetings.
And the last meeting was in Temecula.
And the last meeting was in Temecula. So we bounce the meetings from location to location so that it's not that somebody always has to drive down. In fact, we were at Grace San Marcos, we were at Temecula, it's just this, now we're moving back south. So
okay.
We constantly rotate and move.
Oh, okay.
And I didn't
all
bring
right.
with me a list of all the parishes, but I do know for a fact that both Fallbrook and Temecula are connected.
Is this a month?
You had a representative that came.
Quarterly.
Yeah, I can look at the list. But anyway.
But we
that's
have a newsletter that gets
yeah.
that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Does anyone else have a question?
Get your name.
Yes. Camp Stevens is really wonderful.
Yeah.
But have you thought about taking him tent camping somewhere and having a program? I was a Girl Scout leader, and I was also the campus director for a service unit. And we took the Girl Scouts on large encampments. I was wondering if that was something. Because it's different, because they have to plan their own meals, their own food.
Mm-hmm.
It's you know, in my perspective, they weren't shopping. They had their list, they went shopping.
Uh-huh.
And then there were programs, because it was a big weekend, there were programs that we brought in, that we brought people in from the community.
Jermaine, we have, if I can respond to that, we have, we've considered it, and there was kind of stirrings about going up to Palomar Mountain and even the bishop coming and being in the tent. And some of the Camp Stevens orientation is actually my push, my doing, so I'll own it. To give the students a sense of a safe place other than just their own church. Because, again, a lot of youth ministry historically has been ad hoc, and because youth ministers have been a bit of a revolving door, if students, and there's a lot of studies on this, a lot of literature on every adolescent needing essentially five adults to raise them, five mentors other than their parents. And if we can't get staying power with mentors or you know, priests in process, often this happened to Kelly Mahoney, happened to myself, get sent a lot of different places. So, and some of what we do is youth ministry. Nevertheless, if there's a lot of movement, there's a lot of movement even in Camp Stevens staff, then what we're giving them is place, location. So we've tried to kind of make Camp Stevens a nurturing place for faith. It won't be the only place that we go in the future, and they do camp at Amore Ministries and the mission trip, summer mission, but I'm very hopeful that orientation towards Camp Stevens is kind of a mutually beneficial relationship, really. Students can go back there and be camp counselors. They can learn how to do ministry there, and it's also their kind of safe place, their second home, so
yeah, I wasn't saying not to do that, but
addition.
Consider
in addition. And I think if we get to that, you know, having many more offerings in the course of the year. So right now, when you think about it, when you're from the desert and you think, oh, this is a bit overwhelming because it's so far, I'm really hopeful that the connection that's strong diocesan-wise is retreats, that we retreat together, because I'm cognizant that a lot of youth groups don't get to retreat. That's a lot of infrastructure you need just to set that up. And that we do mission together, and then convention we do together, just like we do as a diocese. And then we do some leadership and training together. And then these events that sometimes are more, you know, if it's laser tag in Pacific Beach and you're not coming from Fallbrook, I understand. So I'm hopeful that the mission area, you know, connect collaborative-wise, but then also I think what's been built is that those who are part of the collaborative can think in terms of their mission area, what can we do together. So.
And another piece of the Camp Stevens that I think we probably forgot to mention when we were covering the retreat aspect is that they actually joined the collaborative. So we do get some extra programming from them that we don't pay for.
Yeah.
So, you know, we have people come to the campfire with guitars and sing songs for us and lead different workshops that, because they're part of the collaborative, they just gift to us. So that really does help us keep the cost of it down, and that's been a great blessing.
It's wonderful.
Oh, good. Thank you. Thank you. We think it's wonderful, too. We do. Yes?
I just wanted to say, my name is back in Sanders and Mesa. You know, coming in today, not having known anything about this, you guys, the passion that's behind this, and how this is just so, so incredible what you guys are doing here. I wanted to leave everyone with that comment. Our church and where we're at, this is, you know, I'd really like to talk to you. It's a great resource for us, but I wanted to ask, have you ever thought about maybe a Facebook page?
We have one.
Yeah, I mean, that's great.
So, well, two things on that. The EDSD youth page is becoming the collaborative page. We're moving that over now, and that will be the public page. But we have a private group. It's actually a secret group, so you have to connect with me in order to be connected to it, where we all talk and connect together. And the reason why that group is secret isn't because it's some exclusive club, but in order to protect our kids.
Right.
So that's why we operate that one, which is the leadership people, is a secret group. But I would love to connect you to that afterwards, and I so appreciate your feedback.
And you guys should be so proud of this. This is
awesome.
And just as the diocese together, this is a great thing we're doing here. I mean, my heart's bouncing. I'm doing this stuff right now. I'm like, oh my gosh, you guys are doing some incredible stuff here. So.
Thank you. Our hearts are bouncing. A little less now that the technology works.
Yes, one more thing. There's opportunities for us within this to develop groups, regional groups.
Yes, mm-hmm. For sure.
That's what I think.
Yeah.
We get to meet people that are in our area. But also excited about the people outside of our area, what they're doing too. So.
Yeah, and that is something that has happened pretty naturally with subsets doing things together too.
Can I just make? I think it's clear, but logistically connecting. I know that's been in the past. I don't know how to get the information. You connect via the one who administrates all of this beautifully.
Yes.
So once you're connected through Charlotte, she will get you on these monthly emails and keep you posted and introduce you to the Dropbox where all sorts of flyers are uploaded, so you're never kind of without resources. But also an FYI, the diocese is now managing the registration for significant retreats and mission trips and even convention, which is so great, so that people will pay directly through the diocese. If you have some sort of exception or scholarship need, you can communicate through the diocese. You can always ask Charlotte or anyone on the collaborative questions, but I just want that to be abundantly clear that there's kind of a clearinghouse of communication. I wanted to say as well that I plead with you when you are in your mission areas or going back to your own churches to communicate with your clergy. Sometimes I think we have a structure that gets flipped, and so the people doing youth ministry are then taking their cues perhaps from clergy who are unaware that there's a diocesan mission trip or an international mission trip opportunity. So before your kind of clergy or the vestry is dreaming of, let's send all our youth to Chile next summer,
check in with what's the collaborative up to, only because it's very hard to produce a trip to Chile for three youth, or when your chaperone gets sick or leaves, when the collaborative is doing something that might also nurture them, because the students will have some, you know, retreats and some night watch and some events through the year where they're bonding and they're learning to do discipleship together, not only for the sake of the diversity, but also for what's learned when you go with a refugee from Sudan on a mission trip to Honduras or to EYE in Philadelphia. There's something about that that's so beautiful that's missed if we say, no, let's all kind of rebuild our own, you know, reinvent the wheel ourselves. So I encourage you to kind of be a part of that conversation.
Yeah? Besides, obviously you have to go through the diocese, I forgot what they call it now, but safeguarding.
Yes.
Do you, for adults to become involved with the youth and working on them, do you also ask them to get go through at least
a background check?
Yes.
So anybody that goes on a mission trip, on a retreat, or anything like that, has been through Safeguarding God's Children and is background checked.
Okay.
But they are expected to do that through their home parishes, not through the collaborative. Doesn't facilitate that. It's just required that we get the information that has been done.
Oh, I thought individuals had to just go and do it.
Yeah, well, you can do it completely on your own, but a lot of times who's going is a church leader, and so therefore you do it through your parish.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah.
And we have I know that I'm not remiss as I look at all of these people that I have connected with and telling you that safety is our paramount concern in all things when it comes to youth ministry. We want them to have fun, but they can have fun after they're safe. Yeah. So I would like to say, when Monica was up here talking, and I was just thinking about it, it's funny how it's so symbiotic for us to get to work in an office together, and a lot of times things percolate right in there when we're with each other. But one of the things that was just kept coming up to me is that one of the things we didn't talk about is what the kids feel like when they get to see each other all this time. That we're not talking about the kids in their own parish that they get to see, but like to, and I'm not a kid, in case nobody noticed, but when I got here today, two of the faces I first saw were Sydney and Tessa, and Sydney lit up to see me because she saw me first, and I lit up to see her because we've had these amazing experiences together, and I know, you know, when they were up front leading us this morning so beautifully and eloquently, I knew they both sang in the choir already, right? Because I've been on a trip with them. And my daughter, when she goes on things, she's asking me in advance, is Jennifer going to be there? Is Sydney going to be there? Is Felix coming? And these are kids who live all over our diocese, right? Like, this isn't, you know, is Taquaje coming? You know, they know each other, and they've built these relationships now. And so, you know, it's like the 6 degrees of separation, and we have just expanded their entire world just through this.
Yes, I'd love to add something to what you just said, just speaking personally. When I came into my youth program at St. James, I inherited basically nothing. There had been some issues, or not issues, but there had been a lot of interims, and there had been a lot of things that had fallen to the side, a lot of turnaround, a lot of people leaving that idea, well, they've all gone to college, they're not coming back. And the San Diego Youth Collaborative is what restarted our entire program. And I showed up, and I remember like knowing what I was getting myself into, but not quite realizing it, and being really overwhelmed. And then I found the Youth Collaborative, and basically all of the programming that I do has kind of centered around the collaborative and through these little relationships that have been made within the collaborative, subsets that Charlotte was just talking about. Alex Howard has created multiple events for the beach churches, you know, so it's really easy for me, sometimes even I feel a little isolated up in La Jolla, to come down and meet in PB, Pacific Beach, and we can do things with our groups together. And I just wanted to kind of reemphasize the importance of those relationships, because I've only been doing this for 4 months, and I've kind of adopted some different tactics of going about rebuilding my youth program, and now it's an actual program. And it wasn't a program before. I don't think I wanted to admit that, but it wasn't a program before, and now it is, and there's a lot of support from my church, and I've gone to my clergy members, and I've said, this is the Youth Collaborative, this is what we're doing, and they didn't know. They simply didn't know that this thing existed, and now they're really passionate about it, too. So just to kind of, like, beat a dead horse. it's a really great thing.
Yes. I want to say one more thing about the diocesan participation. The Youth Collaborative has kind of spurred the diocese into also focusing more on youth.
Right.
And the Executive Council, which I'm a member of, is looking at youth as one of its focuses. Mm-hmm. And kind of, it's been a symbiotic relationship between the Youth Collaborative and the diocese. And we're just really excited about the relationship with the diocese and the relationship between the Youth Collaborative and the opportunities it's given us for youth all over.
This is so important because one of the statistics for dying churches is that you're losing all your youth.
Mm-hmm.
And if you want to grow and be vibrant, you have to be attractive for young people.
Yeah,
very true.
So now I am not wearing a watch. Does anybody know how we are doing?
Right up there.
We have 4 minutes.
We have 4 minutes.
Wow.
I know. 4 minutes. So before I round up with a last round of thank yous and appreciations, I do want to say that I did put, if you feel like you want to connect to me and you're going to forget from up there on the screen, I put a stack of business cards over there. We are a collaborative. We work in community. But I do handle the communications piece of that. So if you want to take my card, I can definitely get you connected with whatever it is that you need to find, point you to people in your area that you want to collaborate with, tell you about upcoming events, and make sure you're connected. And then additionally, there are flyers here for Wild Adventure, April 29th to May 1st at Camp Stevens. Today, what is it and why are we doing it monthly? A listing of EDSD upcoming events, including today and the leadership retreat, and then the collaborative dates are written on there as well, and then this evening's Youth Unite at the Cathedral. Now, technically, registration is closed for that, but I'm telling you that if you text Robin, because she put her phone number and says text me on here, if you have kids that want to go tonight, she will say bring them. Because it's just a tremendous offering, and I cannot overestimate the value of it. It is just a tremendous offering for all of us. So thank you all for coming. Please stand up, all of my leader friends. Elaine, you too. I didn't know you were coming. Are you sitting up here? But these are the people in the room who have already had contact with the collaborative. Many of your churches are connected, whether it be a vestry member or that we've seen one of your priests or somebody at the collaborative with us, but it never hurts to double check. So putting your email on the list, it just gives you one more avenue to know what's going on.
Thank you.